Good afternoon. All right, how are we? What a great group today. My name is Judy Pryor Ramirez, and I am the Director of Civic Engagement and Social Justice here at Lang. And like I mentioned earlier, I have the privilege of introducing this wonderful panel today. I want to start with a quote by Bell Hooks and Teaching to Transgress. We're celebrating the anniversary of this book, so let me share this one here. The learning process comes easiest to those of us who teach, who also believe that there is an aspect of our vocation that is sacred, who believe that our work is not merely to share information, but to share in the intellectual and spiritual growth of our students. To teach in a manner that respects and cares for the souls of our students is essential if we are to provide the necessary conditions where learning can most deeply and intimately begin. I confess, like my t-shirt says, I transgress. So what does that mean in the academy, right? What does it mean to resist in the classroom? For me, it means to go against the academic grain by situating knowledge from the students' lived experiences, by developing communities of practice where learning is contextual and meaningful, removing power hierarchies and employing a teachers as learners and learners as teachers philosophy, engaging the city and the world through applied research and projects, demanding a critical and self-reflexive practice through regular reflection and assignments, and ultimately inspiring my students to create new forms of knowledge, ways of knowing, thinking, and instilling in them the courage to transform the world. Today we'll hear from Imani Perry about theory and practice in and outside of the classroom, followed by a dialogue with Bell Hooks, Carolyn Crowley, Zyla Eisenstein, and Shannon Winnipist. Allow me to introduce our guests. Imani Perry is a professor in the Center of African American Studies at Princeton University. Come on in. Find some seats. Join us. It's all good. We're in family.
I'm so happy to see you. I just want you to come forward.
Come on in. There's some seats here. I see folks are utilizing the floor in some ways as well. We can be creative today.
Welcome.
All right. I'll go back. And Imani Perry. Imani Perry, professor in the Center for African American Studies at Princeton University and a faculty associate in the program in Law and Public Affairs. She's the author of More Beautiful, The Embrace and Transcendence of Racial Inequality in the U.S., as well as other books, numerous scholarly articles, popular essays, and book reviews. We have Carlin Crowley, a professor of English and director of the Cassandra Voss Center for Women and Gender Studies at St. Norbert College. Carlin's scholarship focuses on gender and popular culture and religion in the field of women and gender studies. Her book, Feminism's New Age, Gender Appropriation and the Afterlife of Essentialism, examines why so many women are interested in New Age culture rather than civic feminist expression. We also are joined by Zyla Eisenstein, one of the foremost political theorists, teacher scholars, and activists of our time. She has written feminist theory in North America for the past 35 years. Her 12 books have tracked the rise of neoliberalism both within the U.S. and across the globe. And she also has written critically about the attack on affirmative action in the U.S., the masculine bias of law, the racism of patriarchy, and the patriarchal structuring of race, and the newest gendered and class formations of the planet, among other topics. Shannon Winnebust is a queer feminist anti-racist scholar and teacher who has been reading, teaching, and loving and working with Bell Hooks for a long time. Author of Queering Freedom in 2006, she is very excited to see the publication of her next book with Columbia University Press, Way Too Cool, Race and Ethics in the Neoliberal Times in 2015. She is currently associate professor in the Department of Women and Gender and Sexuality Studies at Ohio State University. And of course, Bell Hooks. Bell is among the leading public intellectuals of her generation. Her writings cover a broad range of topics, including gender, race, teaching, and contemporary culture. This fall marks the 20th anniversary of the publication of Teaching to Transgress, Education as a Practice of Freedom, Dr. Hooks' seminal text on educational practice. This week-long residency is an opportunity for our new school community to directly engage with Dr. Hooks and her commitment to education and learning as a place where paradise can be created. So let me end by saying that the new school is a place where students can come to understand, contribute to, and succeed to this rapidly changing society. And we are proud to host this series with Dr. Hooks to help foster the critical thinking that's necessary for this challenge. So I invite you to join the dialogue today. Talk with us on social media. Use our hashtag on Twitter and Facebook. It's hashtag BellHooksTNS. Thank you and enjoy the panel.
It's so delightful to be here. I'm going to try not to talk for too long because I'm so eager to hear the panelists, but I do want to take the opportunity to spend some time recognizing and honoring someone who has meant so much to me, both intellectually and personally. I first met Gloria, also better known as Bell Hooks, when I was 18 years old as an intern at South End Press. And I knew who she was already. I knew she was brilliant. I knew she was well known. I knew she was a leading feminist thinker. But I was delightfully surprised at my first encounter. She walked into the press one afternoon wearing a cranberry red shift dress, blood red toenail polish, and outside there was a bright red Mercedes, and she was fly. And her voice, in a word, sounded like home to me. High-pitched, melodious Southern, a voice that, in which I could hear patent leather shoes, clap games, pressing combs, arm babies, hip babies, knee babies, Argo starch, bleach and work, times hard, laugh harder. She had the sense of play and poetry and grace in her presence that I took to be my inheritance, and what she did with it was frankly breathtaking. It was different. Different in a sense because she was free. And I don't mean I hadn't met women who were free before. I came from a family of free women. But she was free in a distinctive way that I came to understand as particularly feminist, intellectual, and black all at once. Free in a way that I would see in some others, June Jordan, Toni Morrison, Aretha Franklin, something beyond the genius. She valued her voice, spoke with authority, in the languages of theory as well as the vernacular, the language of spirit as well as politics. I love to see her spar with critical pedagogues like Peter McLaren and Henry Giroux, and with my then future professor Cornel West. She charmed them even when she eviscerated their arguments with her stunning intellect. One afternoon, the editor who I was assisting, Tanya McKinnon, put Gloria and Cornel on speakerphone as they were working on Breaking Bread, Insurgent Black Intellectual Life, and she told me to write down the titles of all the books they referenced, which was a lot. And those conversations gave me a bibliography to turn to. Her presence emboldened me in ways I only apprehended years later. What I grew to understand is that she wasn't looking for a fight. She sought understanding, but she also wasn't afraid of a fight because the stakes were high, and the stakes for her were people, living, breathing, existing people. She wrote in her chapter in the book titled Black Women Intellectuals, never think of intellectual work as being divorced from the politics of everyday life. I consciously chose to become an intellectual because it was that work which allowed me to make sense of my reality and the world around me. Later, when I read Teaching to Transgress, I learned that she was inspired to do Breaking Bread by reading Paulo Freire's book Learning to Question, which for me was something of a full circle moment. I had grown up amidst leftist intellectuals and activists, in all the places I had lived, from Birmingham, Alabama, to Milwaukee, to Cambridge, Massachusetts. And it was a world in which I was entrenched in, but something different happened when I first met Paulo Freire as a high school student. I sat across from him at a dinner party, and I was starry-eyed, and starry-eyed not just because he was an extraordinary intellect, but because he talked about beauty and food and poetry and love. He was an aesthete as well as a revolutionary. And it was also clear he had some patriarchal tendencies, as evidenced by several of the interactions I witnessed. But he was so loving to me and to everyone in our midst. And One, and I mention this one because I wasn't surprised to learn later that Bell Hooks is the one person who challenged him aggressively on his gender politics and impacted his subsequent works. And two, something that I saw in both of them, the most beautiful intellectuals attend to the wholeness of the human condition. Revolution cannot be without beauty. She stands in that tradition. The first book I read by Bell Hooks was Yearning. I picked it up off the shelf in the South End Press office, and her titles lined the shelves of the basement digs of the now defunct South End Press. Yearning beckoned me. It was a pretty yellow book. One essay in particular, Third World Diva Girls, captured my imagination. She wrote of young women who she mentored, young women of a sort that I was imagining myself becoming. She used the word diva in the operatic sense of the word, identified by their excellence, third world in the political sense, identified with the colonized and oppressed, and wary of third world elites as well as Western elites. Third world in the sense of upending Western hegemony and white supremacy, revolutionary divas. It was a textual embrace given to those of us who adore critics from afar, but who often heartbreakingly encounter them as mean in real life. It was also an embrace for those of us called too angry, too loud, too much, and therefore hurtful to white feminists. It was a reminder that some of us are too willing to attack each other as though the black feminist title is a zero-sum game. It was a challenge to not become divas in the negative behavioral sense, to not make oneself ugly in ego as our intellects and reputations grow. I took every word of the essay to heart. She says in that essay that one of the most important dimensions of feminism is a feminist ethics. Patriarchal ideas distort the mind, therefore we must be about the work of undoing with the feminist ethics. And that was key to how I came to see myself as a feminist. And I wanna talk about three aspects of the legacy of Bell Hooks as for lessons of the present moment as we remember the call to transgress. And the call to transgress is critically important now, I think, for educators, particularly as there's an assault on public education. There's an assault on any conception of being educated that isn't completely tied to a kind of a quantitative monetary value. So the call to transgress is pressing at this moment. And the first part of this legacy that we need to attend to is leftist politics. And I don't mean I vote for the Democratic Party, liberal left, I mean real left, right? We live in a cruel, capitalistic, and neo-colonial world. And if you can't understand the dimension of this work, you can't understand her work, rather, if you don't understand her deep critique of capitalism and the corporate sphere.
Right.
She writes, quote, white male supremacy encourages the use of abusive force to maintain male domination of women. It is the Western philosophical notion of hierarchical rule and coercive authority that is the root cause of violence between those who dominate and those who are dominated. It is this belief that is the foundation on which sexist ideology and other ideologies of group oppression are based. They can be eliminated only when this foundation is eliminated. This is a radical vision. In the 21st century, we may celebrate how the formal structures of colonialism and Jim Crow are gone, and how in Western nations the law does not formally deny women, though it still regulates gender, and how it proclaims that it intends to enforce feminism abroad through diplomacy and influence, and that is the patriarchy of Western feminism as exported through NGOs. But what has filled the space of highly structured oppressions is pervasive dehumanizations through the unbounded neoliberal marketplace. Markets, more so now than ever, are global and they ravage. They sell violence, they fuel violence, weaponized violence, state violence, militaristic violence, intimate violence, street violence, the violence of hunger and isolation. They're rampant and ubiquitous. We are bought and buy, sold and sell cheaply, especially if one is coily haired and brown. Market logic says, quote, it's not racism or sexism, it's preference, it's choice. Okay. Market citizenship is like the Borges story, the Lottery of Babylon, where a drawing might condemn one to death or destruction. The last nine lines of which say, Babylon is nothing but an infinite game of chance, with worse odds the darker you are. If we are to be feminists, we're supposed to be concerned with the consequences of violence, with the diminishment of a person because of the accident of their bodies, their longings, their shapes, and their categories. Neoliberalism as an economic policy and not just as a theory has wreaked particular havoc on black women, because when the market rules, the safety net disappears and racism and sexism thrive. For example, snap cuts that injured black women and children disproportionately, the rights of workers diminishing, the public sector that employs black women disproportionately in the post office and education and social services is eroding. On the free market, because we are deemed less valuable, less worthy, and the competition is inhumane, we become fungible rather than fully human. At the same time, the black woman intellectual of the 21st century is cast into a marketplace. That marketplace sees a value in the ascension of one or two, no more than five, who are like her, black woman. So she is encouraged to compete. She's expected not to speak with her own integrity as a barometer, but to produce content and entertainment for corporations, both educational and media ones. And the more she does this in ways that satisfy the desires for the powerful to speak diversity but practice exclusion, the more she wins. Her mind is now a potentially effective commodity, something newish or a novelty. But if she is free, she will eventually betray those for whom she makes money, because she wants to speak the truth. She wants to transgress, and as bell hooks writes, quote, it is imperative that we maintain hope, even when the harshness of reality may suggest the opposite. So I'm going to try to remain hopeful. But that requires work. Neoliberalism can warp the intellect. Even the refreshingly democratic spaces of social media and the new birth of intellectual collectives lend themselves to hierarchies of attention and opportunity. We can't fully escape it, but we can recognize it, and we can fight for our humanity. At present, we who are in the public and carry the title black feminist are not required to be accountable to black women in their lives. Ethics demand, however, that we choose accountability and love. Feminism is not a brand. It is a way of reading and a liberation praxis. Bell Hooks writes, quote, despairing of the possibility that feminist revolution will occur, many women once committed to working to eliminate sexist oppression now focus their attention on gaining as much power and privilege as they can within the existing social structure. Feminist activists now know that women are likely to exercise power in the same manner as men when they assume the same positions in social and political arenas. She wrote this as a warning, and this warning is even sharper now than when she first issued it. We have to have ethics and values that transcend the question of where we fit in the marketplace. We have to have an intellectual practice that is not bound by the quest to be famous. Famous, fickle, so is status, and so is employment. We need an intellectual practice, a way of seeing who we are that is motivated by the desire to live the life of the mind, to live well and good, and to revel in our individual and collective humanity. And part of that work, as she has consistently challenged us to, includes undoing our adherence to patriarchy. Right. A particularly important dimension of this is the idea that includes a rejection of not simply male domination, but domination, period. It eschews a feminist politics that is about women becoming patriarchs as the end, or assuming that all men are or aspire to patriarchy. Her feminism is, to repeat yet again, grounded in ethics. Bell Hooks stands in the Marxist tradition. Right? That's one thing that she's always brought with her, one that is unflinching in its attention to the operations of capital and its trafficking in prurient spectacles of our bodies, its pornographic displays of exploitation, and its uses to perpetuate inhumanity. But she avoids the detachment that plagues so much Marxist analysis, which takes me to my second point, which is that she speaks to the emotional lives of people, and particularly black women. She tells our secrets, unloosing the corset of our restraint, a respectable, stifling restraint with too much act right and not enough feel good. When I spoke earlier about her discussion of a feminist ethics, it indicated her attentiveness to emotional well-being, also practices of self-care that are necessary to live and breathe as feminists and as women, if we want it all to be healthy. One afternoon over 20 years ago, as we were walking through Back Bay in Boston, she said it was a group of us, this is the life we should be able to have, to wake, to have a leisurely breakfast, to write and think for 4 hours or so, surrounded by beautiful things, flowers and art and comfortable furniture, then have lunch, go outside, go to a park or shop, see friends if we wanted to. And this, of course, was sounded like heaven to me. And it was a gift that I would grow to understand further in her work, in her Black Women Intellectuals essay, that describes in particular the work of undoing the sense that we, Black and female, were not supposed to do intellectual work, that there was such a thing as being too smart. It asserts that we should stop apologizing and cleaning up behind everybody else and start imagining from our own needs and desires, and that was what that vision was about. I also grew to understand this reverie is connected to a life praxis and philosophy. Emotional tending and attentiveness are necessary in order to recognize ourselves as fully human and to do our greatest work. In 1996, I was diagnosed with systemic lupus, and in 2013 with Graves' disease. And in between those diagnoses, I was married, had two children, marriage ended, saw my career take off in one field and decided that I didn't like it very much and left that for another and started over. And I've emerged out of all of that into a life that is at once beautiful and grief-filled and demanding. I've had some form of hospitalization or hospital equipment in my home and some form of surgery every year for the past 4 years, always in the second semester when I'm most depleted with the unending tasks and still reaching for a way to fulfill my calling. But I believed, and this is really important when I'm talking about the legacy that she offers with about self-care and self-attentiveness, I believe that I deserve some ease. I believe that the work I'm going to do in the world requires stillness and solitude and grace. I'm a thinker and a writer. And when my father died this summer, and I spoke to Gloria about my grief, she reminded me that I could sit with my suffering too, that I might falter and be weak and even feel broken, and that none of that was at odds with who I took myself to be. Neither feminists nor intellectuals are impervious to life and its ravages. The work of gendering is powerful. Women, think about the times when you run around all day and don't eat, when you stay up all night to do tasks for friends or families or coworkers or mentees, knowing you won't have a moment to catch up on that sleep, the exhaustion. Think about the times when you play small so as not to unnerve. She's been telling us for 5 decades to let that shit go. To care enough about ourselves to not simply fight for the world to be less cruel, but to not repeat its cruelty upon our own very precious bodies, minds, and hearts. She has laid the path bare. Hard-headed, we still need to be told. We still have a great deal of work to do. But she writes, quote, "Teachers must be actively involved, committed to a process of self-actualization that promotes their own well-being if they are to teach in a manner that empowers students. And this reminds me, at least, that my calling is in vain if it is not applied to me as much as to the young people who I stand in front of. I'm teaching myself, too." And finally, the spiritual work. Her concern with interiority moves between the psychological and the emotional to the spiritual. Interiority refuses binaries of mind and body, reason and emotion, intellect and affect. It's all there in the constitution of a self, an us, a being. The wounds of passion, the stigmata we carry, are testaments to bear witness to the ugliness of this world, particularly to the embodied person that is Black and female, that which is named monstrous, deemed other, cast aside, us. The gospel that was read in countless churches yesterday came from the book of Matthew, and it included Jesus' citation of the following scripture. "The stone the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. The Lord has done this, and it is marvelous in our eyes." Feminist praxis and ethics can borrow from this irrespective of one's faith or absence thereof, in that it requires placing a cornerstone in every edifice of our imagination and our politics. Gloria, thank you for making girls like me, like us, your cornerstone. But more than that, for modeling how to do so, a pedagogy of the oppressed, a moral code with rejected stones at the center. Gloria, singing to those cornerstones becomes a doxology for those of us who believe in liberatory feminisms, whose calling is to teach emancipation. We ought to heed her guidance, listen to the peals and chimes of her bell. Her expansive intellect has always been in the service of us. We come of age as thinkers through her brilliance. She makes complicated ideas beautiful, and so the young ones, thirsty, drink from the font with eagerness, growing bigger and fuller with each passing gulp. The older ones have moved through many pages and many thinkers, and we keep returning to her because we know that there isn't an idea in contemporary progressive feminist or black cultural politics that she hasn't covered more than once and brilliantly. I remember when Therese's book, Who's Afraid of Post-Blackness, came out, and I thought, well, Gloria wrote that in an essay in Yearning on postmodern blackness about 20 years ago. And it was on the very same topic. And the principal difference, I believe, was that I believe hers was far more politically progressive, more concise, and more nuanced and smarter. In that piece, she at once held that, yes, we must deconstruct monolithic conceptions of blackness, but also understand the political usefulness of collective self-conceptions. And in Teaching to Transgress, she questioned why folks are so invested in pointing out how marginalized people are essentialist. What are the stakes of such elite investments? She wrote a decade and a half ago about the abuses attending the corporal punishment of children. But as she always has done, she refused to simplistically render boogeymen and stereotypes in the process, saying, quote, in a culture of domination where children have no civil rights, those who are powerful, adult males and females, can exert autocratic rule of children. All the medical facts show that children are violently abused daily in this society. Much of that abuse is life-threatening. Many children die. Women perpetuate this violence as much as men, if not more. A serious gap in feminist thinking and practice has been the refusal of the movement to confront head-on adult female violence against children. In Black Looks, published over 20 years ago, she recognized the liberatory and transgressive possibilities of genderqueer expressions of identity and questioned, nevertheless, the then only nascent trend of making black queerness into a spectacle, a curiosity for mainstream consumption. Emotions have never been subsumed to the economy in her work, but the economy has always been integral to her analyses, right? Media corporations and the like. At the same time, she reminds us that intimacy is also a part of the structure of domination, and yet love always matters. All that to say, not only has she given us legions of important ideas, but she reveals the pathways of her ideas by citing other thinkers consistently and in detailed fashion, right? Which is quite rare and increasingly in the academy. There's space for disagreement in person and on the page with her because she never requires absolute agreement to recognize the value of another's work. She reads works as much for what they give as what they get wrong, a generosity that is sadly often abandoned by scholars. At the same time, she won't hesitate to passionately assert her disagreement with anyone, beloved or stranger. What is even more extraordinary is that she explores the range of social and political questions from different lenses. What is the task of the writer? What do different forms lend themselves to exposing? Poetry, prose, memoir, essay, experimental fiction, and creative scholarship. She reveals herself. She's a philosopher. She writes as a teacher, a critical pedagogue, as a person in spiritual practice, as a woman, and I cannot overstate the importance of her as a person who made space for black women's sexuality as a healthy part of the whole person and not to be hidden under nationalist or bourgeois Victorianism. We are embodied, we are flesh, love these hands, love these lips, love these legs, like baby sugs in the clearing and hip-swinging womanish girls, at once undoing, returning to when we loved being inside our skin more than we worried about what it meant from the outside in. At the end of Gabriel Garcia Marquez's novel, The Autumn of the Patriarch, the lifelong dictator who is representative of that 20th century political form that so dramatically captured the problem of domination, dies, and the people rejoice. And Marquez describes how, quote, frantic crowds took to the streets singing hymns of joy at the jubilant news of his death, an alien forevermore to the music of liberation and the rockets of jubilation and the bells of glory that announced to the world the good news that the unaccountable time of eternity had come to an end. Bells of glory in Spanish, or Gloria, for the end of an eternal patriarch. In 1976, the soul group Enchantment released a song called Gloria, and I can't sing, so I'm not gonna sing part of it, but in it, the lead singer sings quite beautifully, I don't wanna see Gloria, Gloria, I don't wanna see another day without your love. We don't want to see another day without her love. The love she preaches, we must make real for all of us. We must teach it, model it, and nurture it. We want to live feminist ethics, critical consciousness, and self-care. We want to cleanse ourselves of the muck of self-aggrandizement and competitiveness, the seductions of neoliberalism and star systems, the fiction that we can only be according to the terms of another. We want love that is not a cliche, but rather a radical commitment to the wholeness of us, all of us. We want to be third world diva girls today and always and for the ones to come. Thank you.
All right, then.
Yeah.
I don't know how I got the job of following that, but wish me luck. That was beautiful. And really beautiful. And called out all the right things for beloved Gloria, Gloria Jean, and for the fabulous Bell Hooks. So suffice it to say that I want to respond in the vein that I've learned from Bell. And it seems to me that the collection of people we have in this room right now, just by looking at all of us, is a testament to the kind of work that Bell Hooks has given us for the last 5 decades. So the theme today is transgress, to transgress, what it means to transgress, something that I'm sure we've all given a great deal of thought to. And the panel, I think, wants to just push that in as many directions as we can, and then, of course, talk transgressively across this borderline of this table. So I come at this question from sort of the long history of Western culture that celebrated transgression in so many different ways. You know, Adam transgresses immediately. Transgression's at the heart of white Western culture. It often doesn't get us anywhere in white Western culture, because the law just tells us how to transgress, and then we transgress, and we think we're liberated, and really we're just doing the work of the law. So I worry about it a lot as a white, queer, feminist, anti-racist person trying to do that work in the world. And lately I've worried about it most in terms of neoliberalism, because I think the language you call out for us there is the language of our day. So neoliberalism here or there, it means many things to many people. I think it's just direct on with the way the market rationality has gotten inside all of us in such an intensive way. And that we think with market rationality, cost benefit, efficiency, what's gonna sell, how we're looking cool. Coolness is the language of the market, it seems to me. And so it's a dangerous thing. So I went back and read some of those boring-ass boys from Chicago who gave us neoliberalism, and it's even more worrisome because Milton Friedman, the granddaddy of neoliberalism, tells us right out that what the market wants more than anything is nonconformity. Let me repeat that one more time. The thing the market wants more than anything is nonconformity, because then it can move along and turn it into innovation and sell it to us. So I'm really concerned that transgression is not nonconformity, that it's not only nonconformity. When I teach and talk about transgression with students, I fear that they hear, well, I'm radical, look what I look like, right? I got the look, I got this, that, and the other, I got the right books. And I think when we take Bell Hooks' work and really work it through all the way, then we see that transgression is something much deeper, much more sustained in a daily practice of beauty, in a daily practice of working across difference that's not just about nonconformity. So I'll call it out in one vein. I really love that Imani gave us the language of ethics. It seems to me the language of ethics is the language we need to speak in. I feel very adamant about that these days because I think it's being erased from us and taken away from us from a variety of places, especially the righteous right and their language of morality. When we think about ethics, then we have to think about how we're responding to difference. Fungibility is the key of the market. So difference becomes fungible. Put that in other kind of words, it means being black, being gay, being queer, being feminist, being whatever these differences are, they just substitute in and out of the market. They don't really, the market doesn't really care what any of those differences mean. And yet I think it wants to fuel a phobia of difference pretty hardcore.
All right.
And the phobia of difference, it seems to me, comes out most strongly in feminist work in the dangers of identity politics, where we just stand up for our one issue. So I'm a lesbian, so I must want to get married. Lord bless my soul. That's a sellout, we know that. But it does seem to me that taking it up as a white person in this, so I speak from my own place of identity, where I don't think being a lesbian is the big thing for me. I think being white is the big thing for me. And I think the big thing for the United States of America is race. And I think we can't get over the ugly, violent, horrible history of race that lives deep inside our bodies. So I'm calling it out that to transgress is to cross against this notion that race is just nice multicultural diversity, and to really dig deep inside all of us to think about what it means to think across race and to act ethically across race. And that's not about being nonconformist. So I open it up to you there.
Or come over to this one if you want to
get
stand.
It in stand or whatever you like.
Does this come off?
Yeah.
Great.
There you go. So honored and humbled to be on this panel. My name is Carlin. I'm also a graduate of the Bell Hooks Academy. As someone who read Bell Hooks when I was 19 in women's and gender studies, and then I spent my career in the academy in women's and gender studies. I'm here in part because we came to know Bell Hooks through a center called the Cassandra Voss Center, and I just want to take a minute to talk a little bit about it, because teaching to transgress, which I'll talk about today, informed the core values of that center and the work that we do and why it did. In the room also today, we have our donor and founder, Kurt Voss, conservative, Fox news watching, start shirt wearing guy, who loved his feminist daughter. He's back there with his iron shirt. We love you, Kurt, who loved his feminist daughter radically, and when she died in a car accident, decided to raise nearly $3 million to build a gender center on our campus in her honor. And in thinking about their radical dialogue and the tradition of Bell Hooks' love across difference dialogue, when we thought about the founding core values of our center and about the beginning year of our center, we dedicated a year to Bell Hooks and her work, right? And the hashtag was Year of Bell Hooks, and now we call it the Eternity of Bell Hooks. That's our new hashtag. But there are a couple key in thinking about the history of teaching to transgress. I wanted to talk about in our core values of being scholarship-driven, welcoming, innovative, and fun. Those are really informed by her radical work. You know, someone at our college, when we founded this year and then knew Bell Hooks was going to come last April, said, is Bell Hooks a person? So that's where we started, right? In Green Bay, Wisconsin. Though I did tell people last night that Green Bay was a stop on the Underground Railroad. And you can row to Canada from Green Bay. It's an intensely white place, right? And a white majority Catholic campus. So what does it mean to take someone who says, is Bell Hooks a person? And over the course of the year, imagine a transformation of the mind and the heart that would allow them to be with Bell Hooks and have the privilege and honor. So we thought expansively in the tradition of her work, what do we want to have her do? So one of our core values is fun, and our tagline is delight resists tyranny. Right, and I'm remembering, let me just take out one of my Bell Hooks bookmarks, you're all gonna be jealous of, where you talk about, I think when teaching at CUNY, that people used to say to you, students seem to be having fun in your classroom, what are you doing wrong? And thinking about pleasure and delight as a resistance to tyranny. And so one of the things that we loved most are her five children's books. And so, which we felt just had not gotten enough due or honor at all. We actually tried to buy up everyone in the country at the same time on the same day so they wouldn't go up on Amazon and we could buy them all and then have them all at the Cassandra Voss Center. And then they funded reprinting the books for the children. So if you want to buy one of the books, we now own most of the Bell Hooks children's books in the country because they're out of print, which we want to think about the politics of that. So we featured her children's book, and before then we had the president of our college in his pajamas have a milk and cookies night to read Bell Hooks children's books on our white majority campus, right? So thinking about at the core of the center, what does it mean to decenter whiteness? Also through delight and pleasure. Is there a way to do that? Could we think about that differently, right? And so we had a room full of children from around Green Bay listening to Bell Hooks with Anna, who's here in the room, saying, when I say bell, you say hooks. Bell, hooks, bell, hooks. That's one of the things we thought about. The other thing we thought about on a Catholic campus, radically, was we wanted to put her in the behind a lectern in our church. We wanted her to preach, and we felt like that was her rightful place. And Aben and Imani, you talked about the spiritual tradition, right? And we felt like a lot, not enough honor had been given to her spiritual work and her, that, you know, her spiritual work. So we asked her to preach, literally. And I remember, Belle, when you picked out songs that we were going to sing, and you said, I haven't been asked to do this since Yale. Just really interesting to think about the academy not asking her to do that work, right? So how race and secularity work together, I think, in interesting ways. And then one of the last things I wanted to talk about was scholarship-driven, right? So we featured her work over the course of the year and out of classrooms and had other people come and talk about her work. George Yancey is a radical philosopher on the black body and the problem of whiteness. That theory, that piece that I read as an undergraduate, right, that theory helped, as she says at the beginning here, in Teaching to Transgress, right? I came to theory because I was hurting. The pain within me was so intense that I could not go on living. I came to theory desperate, wanting to comprehend, to grasp what was happening around and within me. I saw in theory then a location for healing. And for me, as an undergrad, when I first read that essay, that was revelatory because I'd never thought about theory that way, and I'd never thought about myself as an intellectual. And that made sense to me. And so that's also how we featured her work, is to think about theory in really radical, life-affirming ways. So I'm just here to think about applied bell hooks. What does it look like if you use her work at a center and have all these people from the community come and partake in it? I really see this as a spiritual text, and that's how I'm also interested in it. Thank you so much for having me.
Good afternoon. Belle and I met a long time ago. It was early 1970s.
Is that mic working?
I don't think so.
Can you hear me? Is this better?
Yeah.
Early 1970s, Haverford College. Angela Davis had just come out of jail. We all met for the first time at Haverford. Hortense Spillers, some of you might know her name. She was the provost, right? She was the provost then. And I was the unlucky white person to be at this event called Racism and the White Women's Movement. So I don't know, you know, Belle and I have been friends ever since then through all kinds of shit, all kinds of unexpected life, all kinds of learning with and from against each other. So, I mean, we had early debates on what is theory, really hard debates on What qualifies as theory? Any idea? Is any idea theory? And I was trained in political theory. So we had great arguments that deepened and opened the sense of where you look to find political ideas and then how you make them visible when they so often are either silenced or just nowhere to be seen or heard. So when I was thinking about today, of course I was thinking about Bell and the friendship and just how lives happen and get intertwined. But I was also trying to think about the term trans and to really live in and against and across. And of course, I didn't actually choose that as my own life. I just happened to be born to two people who were communists in this country when this country was really hostile. So I grew up with my three sisters, pretty embattled, pretty lonely, pretty ostracized, and white. So there was a way, though, that at that time, the people who were in the Communist Party in this country, most of them were there not on the issue of the economy, but more on the issue of civil rights in this country. And so if you were for civil rights, you often would be part of the Communist Party. So, of course, we grew up in the civil rights movement, my sisters and I. You know, Saturday morning, what did we do? Picket Woolworths. You know, Sunday, you're trying to get out of the juvenile detention center that you were put into. So, and my parents, I never knew how brave they were until I had my own child and wondered, could I really let Sarah go off in a paddy wagon and not know? But anyhow, my point here is that there was no choice. We often said to our parents, don't we get to choose? And they said, no, you know? So there were times where we did just want, we would say, can't you just forget this for the evening? No. So when I met Bell, I had a history. And then that history started to take shape, not in terms of communism, but in terms of the feminist movement. And in my household, the transgressions were me arguing for a semi-autonomous framework for feminism in distinction from communism. It wasn't about, you know, between liberal and left. Okay, so the idea of just all of that, you know, I was kind of thinking as I was walking here across Manhattan this morning, I was just trying to think about the different pieces. The fact that Bell knew my mother made a bond for me that so many people who never met her, I can't have with. You know, it was just too intimate and hard a struggle, but one that she embraced. She'd always say, how's Fanny? You know, and it was like time just collapses and you're together. So one other point that I was thinking about, you know, I'm kind of doing this like tweets, okay? Just take it and drop it and go again. But the other point on this issue is, so when the world is just changing at such a rate, and I would actually take the physicist's argument about singularity, which is that change is always happening, but at certain moments, the change coalesces in such a sense that nothing before is really knowable. So that, in other words, we all know change happens, but you can become a little immune to the fact that certain changes change everything and that we really need to think through about. So then what are we transgressing against in this new moment? So, you know, for me, just the most recent moment was the war in Gaza, that just broke everything for me. And new alignments were registered for me in that. There was just no denying the abomination of what that was and that we in this country allow it. So there are, you know, we could go on. There are some other moments of singularity, but I'm also beginning to wonder if we're not living at a time where the complexity of the changing of all identities in terms of race, in terms of sex, gender, trans, whatever, that for those of us who grew up working so hard to be able to name what they were, and now that they are in such new forms, which doesn't mean better at all, but just means really more complicated, and in some sense overlapping, okay, or intersectional. So the idea here is maybe we are really at this moment today here with Bell needing to understand a new urgent need for transgressing what exists in its enormously brilliant political forms. And I think that we have the responsibility to be as brilliant as our oppressors. Okay, so thank you.
A week ago, I did a conference called Queer for a Day, Queer Now and Always, that was aimed at talking about the solidarities between gay, queer, people of color of all sexual practices. And one of the things that happened there that was not positive for me was that several white men began to kind of whine about not having a voice. And I said that at that moment, I began to channel Dr. Martin Luther King, and I began to speak about John Crawford. And I began to say, here is a black man, a young black man who trusted in the humanity of white people and white men so much that he thought it would be enough to say, it isn't real. We are always subjected to the dehumanization of black masculinity and black men. But think about what it means for a young black man with all that white supremacy has done to us as black people, to still have enough hope, enough faith, enough belief that his voice could be heard, his embodied black voice could be heard. And yet, what we get is the disembodied voice of a white man in a 911 call can have more power over life and death than the real body of a black man speaking, claiming his voice. To me, that is the deep, profound aggression, tyranny, brutality of imperialist, white supremacist, capitalist patriarchy. That black men in this society do not have a voice that can be listened to. The fact that we have a black president has done nothing to intensify a willingness on the part of this imperialist, white supremacist, capitalist patriarchy to hear the voices of black men, of black people. So that when I think about everything people have said here about how we have to up the urgency of our actions, not of simply of our words, but of our actions, because the times are so deeply dangerous. Dangerous to all of us. You know, we understand these black killings as contemporary lynchings. What has been the point of lynching historically? Not to kill individuals, but to let everybody know, this is what can happen to you. You get out of your place, and this is what can happen to you. And we can all be watching.
And let me tell you, if you are rabidly watching these deaths on your TV screen, you are colluding with the imperialist, white supremacist, capitalist patriarchy that makes these deaths spectacle. It is hard to refuse to watch repeatedly, but to engage repeatedly the spectacle is to be part of all that is diminishing the value and life of Black males, of Black people. So that we have to think always, where do we, as Dr. King asked us, where do we go from here? Where do we go with feminism? Where do we go with our critique of imperialist, white supremacist, capitalist patriarchy? The word that is most disturbing to people in that construct is imperialism. Because the word and the life that people in this country deny more deeply than anything else is our engagement with imperialism and imperialist violence. And yet, that's what we get to see all the time on our TV, is our repeated imperialist violence that we deny. So that in coming myself to reading Teaching to Transgress again, I was both a bit awed by how smart it was, but also deeply saddened that so much of what it talks about 20 years ago has actually deepened, worsened, and it was hard not to feel that certain deep despair. That what did these words mean? What did these books mean? Who did they educate for critical consciousness? We're gonna open it up and talk with you. Again, I just am awed by the dissidents. All four of these women are dissident movers in the world. Women who dare, women of great courage. Zila's mom was a woman of courage, love of justice. So that I am just thrilled to be here with them, to be back at the New School. I thank Stephanie and all the crew that make it possible for me to return to the New School. So who's ready to ask a question of any of these folks? Carlin, Shannon, Zilla, who are you? Imani, she's our baby. Wasn't that an awesome, beautiful talk? Yeah. Of course, I couldn't help but hear Imani and know that the three of us have gone through such deep health problems. And there does seem to be a correlation, and Phyllis Chesler has done the most kind of writing about it, about being militantly dissenting as a female and health problems. Because I think we understand, all of us, how deeply stress is as a killer in our society, as a motivator for disease. And I think it's really impossible to be dissident in our society and female without coming up against that level of stress. I mean, read it for yourself. It's amazing how many feminist thinkers, especially, have had tremendous illness, life-threatening illness, in their our lives. Is there a question jumping up? What? Oh, your name? Well, you can hear you. What's your name?
My name is Nassim, and I teach middle school, and I'm trying to break down this kind of stuff to 13-year-olds, and, you know, which sometimes they're very profound and sometimes they're ridiculous, they're 13. And I guess I'm wondering, I'm trying to think about how to ask it, you know, and I'm sure, you know, at first I was like, are there resources that make this kind of thinking more readily accessible for 13-year-olds, but I can do my homework on my own? I guess what I'm wondering is, what would you like to have heard when you were 13? If you can think back, like when you were 13, what would have, in this general direction, what would have been something that you wish you had heard or been exposed to or read that maybe would have been accessible to you, or I don't know, something maybe you read later that I wish someone had told me that when I was 13?
When I was 13, I had teachers that were telling me we didn't read Black people because I hadn't written anything. And then when my father gave me a list of books written by Black people, they told me, well, we don't read those books because they're not very good. So when I think about Carlin, bringing together 100 diverse third graders to listen to bell hooks and to talk with her and to question her, I think, wow, what would that have been like for me at 13? That I, who could not conjure up the image, the voice of a black writer, but here are these 100s in the depths of the whiteness of De Pere, Wisconsin, can remember that they had an opportunity to meet with and talk with a black writer, thinker. So that I think one of the things we can always do in working with children, as I said the other day, is we can be an enlightened witness in the Alice Miller sense. We can bring to children the people they need to see, the people who do the things that we talk about, and that through that living witness, children can be moved and inspired. Somebody else want to speak to that? Everybody up here has children, except me.
We're all your children,
I have a middle school child. My oldest son is in middle school. And this is not exactly a response to your question, but one of the things it made me think of is that for him, as a boy who is being socialized deeply as, you know, to be progressive on in every possible dimension and also going to a progressive school, but he is consistently frustrated by the fact that teachers will say we have these values, we're progressive on gender, we're progressive on race, we're progressive on sexuality, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, and yet not actually cultivate a classroom space that is a safe space to really push through these issues. So, and he's in sixth grade, and he's already identifying an inconsistency between sort of stated values and praxis in the classroom. And so that's the thing that's on my mind. And also, the way that race, the intersection of race and gender operates, at least for him, is that already there are things that he may bring to the classroom that the response that he gets from adults, not this year, but in the past, is sometimes a kind of discomfort about him knowing things as a black boy, right? So I had a teacher say, well, he knows so much about the Great Depression. It's like he read a book. I mean, it's not rocket, right? But I mean, I think a lot of it, you know, in terms of this, you know, the enlightenment, a lot of it has to do with the dynamics that are set up, particularly they're gendered and racialized, that are not, there's kind of, I think oftentimes not enough interrogation about what happens in the lived classroom.
On the Man Up panel this week, there will be a black man coming from Atlanta who teaches anti-racism, anti-sexism to sixth graders. And so if you're around, I'm sure that Oman will have lots to tell us about the work he does in bringing this struggle to end domination into the classroom with his sixth graders. Another question.
One thing I want to add on that real quick.
My sister teaches middle school down in Dallas, and she teaches in a really, there aren't any white kids or English-speaking kids in her school. I think it's a really local issue, right? It depends on who the kids are and where they are. But what I get from her is she teaches art. And art, as you might know, doesn't get tested. There's no standardized testing connected to that. And what that has allowed her to do is create this space where the kids can be real. And they can really be themselves, because they're not always having to do something for a test. And consequently, she's really been able to open up in real ways with them. And it seems to me the biggest thing she's been able to do for these kids is to tell them two things. One, the world's really, really big, which for a 13-year-old is not always the case. And two, change happens. Things do change. We're not stuck. And so talking about what powerful change has been in the past has been a big thing that she teaches as she's doing art with them. So I'm sure you're down with the creative space, but I think our schools are killing creative spaces, and that's part of the problem.
Yeah. Another question? Oh, you saying
something? Can I say one more little thing?
Yes.
I wanted to read this to you from Teaching to Transgress, because we've been thinking a lot about it. This is from Feminist Thinking, page 113. If a black student acknowledges that she is not familiar with the work of Audre Lorde and the rest of the class gasps as though this is unthinkable and reprehensible, that gasp evokes the sense that feminism is really a private cult whose members are usually white. Such black students may feel estranged and alienated in the class. Furthermore, their skepticism about the relevance of feminism may be regarded contemptuously by fellow students. This notion of a private cult, but like how to create radical hospitality in a classroom, you know, and how to eliminate the private cult. So when the person said to me, is bell hooks a person, how do I, with generosity, right, allow that person into not thinking this is a private cult? And I was thinking again, I've been rereading this, right? So when bell hooks ask her students, write about an early experience of race, something as simple pedagogically as that, which is something I use in my classroom, but just what does it mean for 13-year-olds who can very well, I mean, I can think about my 13-year-old self responding to that question and what kind of hospitality that would create in a room if people gave honest answers.
I think the theorizing of hospitality is very interesting because so often we have liberal people who want to help, but that true liberation isn't that one-way agenda. It is the agenda of mutuality, and true hospitality has to extend itself both ways. There's a new book coming out by D.D. Risher called The Soul-Making Journey, and it is a really good theorization of hospitality as a path of resistance. And I mean, think about how many white people of the eat, pray, love category and the rest make their way to cultures of people of color and are greeted with kindness, compassion, hospitality. And yet we never hear the flip side of that. We never get to see the movie of the person of color who comes here and, you know, is able to take all the riches and art and everything back, like Eat, Pray, Love, and start her own little business of beautiful artifacts retrieved from the lives of people of color elsewhere. So that I urge you to read that book when it hits the soul-making room. And its theorization of hospitality. Yes? Your name?
Please use the mic. If you could please, because it's in the archive.
Okay.
If you don't mind, thank you.
Don't be shy.
My name is Mac. I'm from Brooklyn. And I've been really, I've been really interested in the aesthetics of white supremacy and how that has been really a terrorizing force.
All right.
And I just wanted to really talk a little bit more about what it would mean to symbolically move away from those images. Mm-hmm. Even as people of color, you know, like as I am a black person who is committed to feminist practice, what I had to do in order to move away from aesthetic images of patriarchy. And so I'm thinking about what that means for white folks, you know, because I feel like if we want to be a mutuality, we really do have to talk about sacrificing forms of privilege. So I don't know.
Well stated, well said. Anybody want to address that? Who is I?
My name is Melania. I teach kindergarten. And one thing that I am reminded of is the day last year when four of my students came in with jewels on their noses and colored clip-on clips in their hair. And one of the mothers said to me, she's the mother of a Jewish child, she said, I'm so glad to see this because up until now, my daughter's ideal of beauty has been blonde-haired and blue-eyed. And now she is copying you. And I think of the aesthetics of what are we sold as what is beautiful. And two of the little girls who came in with the little jewels on their noses, I have a nose ring, you can't see it, were African American girls. And two of them were white girls. And this idea that, because I'm their kindergarten teacher, I am this person who has a beauty to them that maybe the rest of the world is not interested in. Mm-hmm. But having that growing up, I think, is an important response to what the aesthetics of patriarchy don't necessarily want us to see and don't want our little girls to think of as beautiful because it looks like them.
I'm writing a piece now for Shambhala's son about the whole notion of the white Jesus versus the many-colored Buddha, and what it means. How much has the white Jesus been such a colonizing image in the minds of black people? Mm. And in fact, I started thinking about this a couple of years ago when my brother was saying to me, I can't get the white Jesus out of my head. Mm. And so how can I liberate myself? Mm-hmm. How can I decolonize if I can't move that white Jesus from the frame? And for some people like myself, as a Buddhist Christian practitioner, one of the things that helps move that white Jesus from the frame is actually all the multicolored, multi-shaped Buddhas that suggest, again, a deity that is alive and not static, that is fluid, that is changing, that has many possibilities of shapes. And I think a lot about what would the lives of our children be in this society if black children saw different colored deities, different, not just the idea that we actually still have the white Jesus who dominates our lives. I've been going through my archival stuff, and I see all these little things where I graduated from different Bible stuff, but there is white Jesus on the cover of every single one of those things. And I do have my black Jesus from Guatemala. He's on the cross and he's suffering, but he is there every day of my life to remind me of that, just that different imaging and its impact on our inner soul making, on our inner interior rooms that we're creating. Question? Yes, your name?
My name is Toya Zachary, and I, towards what you just discussed.
Louder, stand up, please.
I was hoping that you would want to write another poem black too.
Well, the second biography to Bone Black is Wounds of Passion. The third one that I'm trying to write is Seducing Simone, which has to do with my own, how did I make myself an intellectual? Without the very imaging that we talk about. I mean, I'm always moved to tears when I hear Imani, because I don't know what it's like to have come up with any kind of image of a black woman thinking in a distant manner in the way that I wanted to think. And so much of what I had to do, I had to create in my own imagination, which was to take the bodies of dead women, white and black, Emily Dickinson, one of my first bodies of people who I learned from. Mm. You know, the amazing level of solitary discipline it takes to write more than 30 books. You know, it ain't because I'm out party, you know. It's not because I'm having the social life that I might want to have. It's a kind, and how to discipline yourself to be in solitude. I mean, I grew up in a small house with seven siblings and mom and dad. Even the desire for solitude was viewed as suspect. Mm-hmm. You know, why do you need to get away from the rest of us? Mm-hmm. What are you doing? And so to claim that space, I had to claim Lorraine Hansberry. Mm-hmm. I had to claim those images of women that affirmed for me the necessity of my working. Virginia Woolf. And the diversity of those women that I had to claim who were my invisible supports. I always tell people that my primary person was Madame Curie. And Madame Curie was an inspiration to me because she went into that lab in her solitary way and worked at her discoveries. And I saw myself as a different kind of scientist going into the laboratory of ideas, working. And so I think that sense of what we image mm-hmm. is so crucial. And it's how imperialist, white supremacist, capitalist patriarchy undermines us again and again, because the power of the image is so great. We would like to think that it's not as powerful as these books, but it is. You know, what we look at every day, what we consume, what we take in and what we give out. It's so hard. The young black woman who braids my hair, her daughter comes over every day with some horrible little ugly white doll that she's playing with. And I say to her, "Don't you have any black dolls?" She says, "Well, you know, who wants to play with a black doll? I don't like black dolls." And I have them, and I am so astounded by the vocalization of her internalized oppression. I mean, I didn't know how to do that at 4 years old, but she's already learned in every way in this culture. The little kids at school have already told her, "You can't be Cinderella, Cinderella ain't black." So she's already learning. And we've been talking about that with Shannon's little girl. She's already learning certain gender containments from other children. And how do we work against that? It's a constant struggle.
Well, I want to say one thing directly to your profound question, Mac, which is the thing that Bell has given me the strength on. My favorite quote that I already put on the wall from Bell Hooks is, "Decolonize your imagination." But that's not easy work. And it seems to me, and the basic line to that for me has been to turn off the television entirely. Entirely, not just in part, but just to turn it off. And I think that's for me, and I've taken strength from my friendship with Bell, that's imperative. The other part of it is that, as she teaches us also brilliantly all the time, is not to let, as a white person, since you said, what does this mean for white folks to change aesthetics, that embracing black aesthetics is still possible without it just being what Bell has so rightfully called out as just spicing up my white bread life, right? So what does it mean to take on a real tradition and history, and to do my homework and to understand what the various strands of other aesthetics are, is still possible. That's what I mean by working across identity politics. The answer isn't, I can't do that because I'll colonize it. That's not the answer. That's not ever what Bell was teaching us, I don't think. It was do it, but do it for real. So I think that's still possible.
Well, I just like to say, I don't agree. I don't think that turning off the TV is the answer. I mean, it might be a strategy, but it is to push hard against and really try to recreate, even if it means, you know, just enormous conflict, okay? And on another note, I don't know if this will be fully understood, but just on this issue of what we imagine and how things can shift. So when my daughter was about 6, she really wanted Barbie dolls. And I said, no Barbie dolls in our house. And then this is me speaking to my daughter. And she says, "Well, how about a black Barbie doll?" So I thought, okay, she's smart. No, we didn't get one. But I mean, just the idea here of, you know, things are fluid. People.
But I'm not getting, you know, what you were saying about television then.
Yeah, me
either. So are you saying that you think television does not do harm, or?
I think it does terrible harm, but I watch it to mobilize me.
Okay.
You know, and to also know what I need to be mobilized against.
Mm-hmm. See, but I think that's where we get into the question of age, because that's something I realized, that it's one thing to be old enough to theorize what you see on television or to have some barrier between you, yourself, and what you see. But that's precisely what somebody from the ages of 1 to 5 doesn't have. The apparatus, huh?
1 to 25.
And that's why I think it's imperative to turn off, especially for black people, because I feel like, come on, where does white supremacy come into our lives? I mean, media is the number one propaganda machine for white supremacy. Jump on in here. Go on.
I'm Michelle Mater. I teach media studies here at the New School. And I think I have a class that I teach called Race, Ethnicity, and Class in Media. Mm-hmm. And what I tell my students to do is to look at what you're watching in a different pair of eyes, and look beneath the surface. Don't just take everything for face value. Look at what really is coming towards you, and take it apart, pull it apart. And we talk about this every week. So I also tell them they need to do the same thing with their little brothers and sisters and nieces and nephews and children. Because it is with the youngest children, back to our middle school teacher and our kindergarten teacher, that this starts, and to start getting them, and don't lower your expectations of those 13-year-olds. They can learn a lot from you know, you just asking them the right questions. And the same thing with the kindergarten kids. Just having them consume, they're gonna be consuming it one way or another. We're not gonna get them everybody to turn off their TV. So we might as well give them the tools to view it differently.
Well, I think that that's a really good question, because I had not seen The Orange is the New Black. And I had been thinking about and reading about Laverne Cox in my trans ally positionality with Janet Mock. And so then I thought, well, I'm going to look at all of this, because I am fascinated continually by forms of popular culture that transcend race, sexual practice, class. You know, it's like, when I hear that everybody's reading a book, I want to read it, because I want to know. We talk so much about diversity and how we can bring the different people together. But then when there is something in our culture that brings people together, it fascinates me. And I'll be talking about that with Laverne on Tuesday night, with what is it about Orange is the New Black that draws people cross class, cross race, cross-sexual practice. I will tell you that some of what I think I find very troubling about what is the draw of the images that we see in this show. I'll just give you an example. If you've watched the show and you watch the evil black woman who was the violent drug dealer, that when Rose kills her, you know, when she's out in the road, and she's her hands are up in the air, just like Michael Brown. And Rose says she was a very rude person and mows her down. And at that moment, I thought about all the black women that people would like to kill, because they see us as angry, difficult, rude. I think about myself taking my, you know, hours of written PhD exams and passing, and then failing the oral exam and being told I did not have the proper demeanor of a graduate student. And I think about the symbolism of that. Whatever you think about the show, but that scene was so much, again, she didn't say, I wanted V, if you know that character, to die, because she was so evil and mean. But the interesting thing was that she isn't saying, I want to get rid of this evil, violent drug dealer. It was, she was so rude, a rude person. Like, and I think about how many white people hear us as people of color because we say something different or think differently, or we are louder, and therefore we should die. I mean, don't ever forget the people who were bombed in Philadelphia because they had their dreadlocks and because people said that they smelled. So that we, the idea that we can slaughter people based on notions of difference. I mean, I think that goes back to what several people spoke about how difference has been sort of turned in on us now. Like, we can use the metaphor of diversity and difference to engage in genocide. Mm-hmm. And in fact, then we can say that the good people of color that whiteness has incorporated stand with us in our extermination of the bad people of color. Mm-hmm. And the one thing I say all the time that people resist, the darker skinned you are as a black person in this society, the greater you are assaulted by white supremacy. People argue violently against that idea when I put it out there. And I think, why is it so hard for people to believe that even racism and white supremacy has its gradations of intimate terrorism, that there are people who suffer more, and suffer more within our own families? You know, I can remember us hating to go to our white-looking grandmother because she was so cruel to our darker-skinned sister. She loved to say things like, a black nigger is a no good nigger, you're blackie, you, I mean, the damage that we have done, the trauma to little kids. And you know, we knew as little kids that she was abusing in some way and violating our sister. We didn't want to go there, we didn't want to witness that. And yet we are still in this. I mean, Lorraine Hansberry says that it is the only thing that should discredit us in the eyes of our children. I mean, why should we still be talking about white supremacist aesthetics? Why should they be dominating our lives so? You know, and why is it that when people talk about Laverne's character, Sophia, when they talk about Beyoncé, there's very little said about white supremacy and the work they do in their images on behalf of white supremacy? Because it's as if people act like, oh, that's old. Oh, it's just old to talk about blondness and white supremacy. And it is, those of you in this room who work with children, you know it's not old. Right. Because you're constantly seeing the pain, the damage, and the bondage that it holds us in. Is there somebody else with a question here? We have 25 minutes. Your name?
Hello, everybody. My name is Dalton.
You may have to stand, sweetie.
Okay. And yell. My name is Dalton. I'm a student here at the middle school. And so my question was a bit more open-ended about the state of affairs of feminism and like a speaker direction. And so earlier you were discussing, you know, the issues of neoliberalism and, you know, non-conformity within that context. And from what I understand, you know, feminism is not just about, not just the empowerment of women, but, you know, gender equality. And so I want to ask, like, how does contemporary feminism not fall into that trap of, you know, neoliberalism? Because, for example, like, today, the idea of success, you know, is you know, more so corporate. Like, you take the example of, like, Hillary Clinton. I mean, she's a woman who's, like, wealthy and powerful, but she's as much of a war hawk and imperialist as Obama.
We were just talking about this.
It's for a woman to have the power to drop as many bombs as men.
Well, I mean, I think that there you have, I mean, something we're all up here as radical feminist thinkers grappling with, that feminism has become almost meaningless as a term when it can be used by anybody to substantiate whatever they do. If it's a woman gaining more money, more power, we can act like that's feminism. I'm really not myself. I am about ending domination. And I see feminism as one of the politics that aids us in this struggle. But I don't see it as about equality. Yeah. Equality with who? Equality with which group of men? Equality with which group of women? I mean, I think that when we stay on domination, I tend to be, and people can disagree here, I see domination as the foundation of these systemic oppressions, and not a theory of, like, you know, the old theory that, oh, when rape came into the world, that's when domination came in, so that we have that male-female dichotomy. I'm interested in notions of origins of domination that look at agriculture. I'm interested in agriculture and the notion of the domestication of agriculture as being central to domination. And if we are looking at what's happening with GMOs and in the environment and crops everywhere, we can see once again how agriculture is playing such a major role in the domination of human life and in the genocidal end of human life. So that I think that part of what's a deep question for us as feminist thinkers is how can we begin to have a, what I think of as a visionary feminism, be more central in people's minds when the make some money, you know, Sex and the City, Lean In, all the forms of feminism that promise women an in the existing money culture. Mm-hmm. Because I don't even think women are that interested in having male whatever. It's money that our culture is being driven by in such a deep and profound way. And so, and we don't even talk about, I mean, how many feminist books do we have that look at the relationship between feminism and money? You know, in fact, we've been told, well, women don't have any money, but actually percentages of white women have lots of money. Mm-hmm. I think in the next decade or something, like, women will control trillions of dollars, but who, what women? What group? Who? Why do we not talk about them? Navigating the Dark Side of Wealth is one book that looks at the inherited wealth of many white women, but we don't talk about that as feminist thinkers. Go ahead, you have a question there, and I'll come back to you in the back in just a sec.
I just want to say,
your name?
John Braden, and it is such an honor and a joy to be in the room here today. 20 years ago, I began my teaching career teaching in New York City in high schools where I replaced the regular teacher who quit in three different schools, and, you know, and I was able to be successful where others left because I transgressed.
All right, all right.
That I was able, but that's when I discovered your teaching to transgress, and I still have wonderful memories of reading that on Saturday mornings in my apartment, you know, with the sun coming in on the yellow cover, and there was something in that book that was just so essential and so healing and so necessary. And so I've been teaching for 20 years now. I teach as an adjunct professor, underpaid, oppressed, and trying to open up these emancipatory spaces and classrooms, you know. Now I'm in Newark at Essex County College, which is, you know, mostly my students are poor, black, from the inner city. And Newark is like a ground zero, by the way, of this whole educational debate that's happening in America. It's really right in the middle of it. But I told my students today that I was going to be coming here, and I said, does anybody know who Bell Hooks is? And nobody, you know, but I had a chance to write your name on the board and say that I'm coming here and all that. But my question has to do with how do we get this message out to a larger and larger audience? And what is the role politics will play in that too? It's interesting that on the day that Bell is going to be in dialogue with Gloria Steinem, I'm so torn because there's a panel discussion on education, a major discussion in the Tishman Auditorium, moderated by Chris Hayes. It would be nice if Bell was on that panel. You know, how do we push it, get it out there politically, even with the use in terms of money? How do we? Is there any way to transform the business culture? Is there any way? Because there's such a divide between the progressives and people in business. And is there any way to build bridges and to sort of utilize, shift money towards liberating people and liberating politics and creating institutions?
Well, I think one of the reasons I invited Kurt here, mm-hmm. that we talked about earlier, that he raised those $2.8 million to open a women's center. I mean, how many white men do you know do that work? Because he is a businessman. He is from the corporate world. He is coming from conservative traditions. I think that we, again, make inroads as individuals, and as individuals who learn from other individuals, so that we learn what is possible, so that I don't see most any kind of sort of collective, like think about how Occupy Wall Street offered us such incredible critiques. But where is that now? We have mobilization versus organization. And our model in this society tends to be one of mobilization. Let's all get together, let's protest, let's look at Ferguson. But where will Ferguson be a year from now? How will it be changed in a progressive way? How will the lives of black people in Ferguson be affected? Even though we're not to denigrate mobilization, but it doesn't produce the location for a fundamental change in that kind of localized environment where there is possibilities for change. There are people in that back. Yes, your name? You have to be louder. Myself think much in terms of those terms, feminine and masculine values. I again think in terms of patriarchy, and you'll hear me say a lot that patriarchy has no gender, so that I think once we rid our minds of that notion that patriarchy has a gender, we can begin to look within ourselves. I look within myself to see, what am I doing to perpetuate the imperialist, white supremacist, capitalist patriarchy? And how I think dress. Shannon, are you going to say something
to
this?
No, but Carlin is.
Oh, okay.
I just wanted to, once again, in the way that Imani also did, note, I teach the will to change, and that's, you know, bell hooks' early work on masculinity, which I would argue came out about 15 years before critical masculinity studies, right? And I, again, don't feel like it gets its due. And I keep teaching it in Intro to Women's and Gender Studies. I'm about to teach it in 2 weeks. My students cry. They read it and they have grief. They have grief about the men in their life and who they want them to be and the conversations they couldn't have. And so we do a lot thinking about, you know, feminist futures, thinking about critical masculinity. What does transformative masculinity look like? And how do we have that conversation as much as we have the conversation about, you know, gender role norms?
Zila, what are you thinking?
Oh, I'm just thinking how hard it is to think about these questions, particularly with, you know, trying to direct myself to your question about masculinity, femininity. How do you take what you want, not take what you don't want? And I do think that the idea of trying to think, even though it seems abstract, but the idea of patriarchy as it's a structural system, but it's also located in our bodies. Mm-hmm. So, so to that extent, you know, you want to be looking everywhere to the possibilities of, to really earnestly figure out what is it that I need, and also what is it that I am standing against in my own self. And that, you know, out of that earnestness, I think, is how we really then try to share that with others, because we each become vulnerable in the political struggle. We're not outside it. We're inside exactly what you're looking towards. So, but it is a process. And going back to earlier, I also think that we really want to see change where it does exist, so that we don't work with what, you know, you can feel, you can start to feel comfortable thinking you know what the borders of blackness are or intersectionality are. And actually, I think the borders of everything are truly shifting for both bad and good reasons. So it's just a time that one really has to be so alert and honest and also brave. And I don't think we're very brave in this, in our culture. I think people are more scared than brave.
But I also think that we don't have those, again, where are our images of courage? And where are our discussions of courage? I mean, I don't think people even know what it means to take a stand for the most part. And that's really sad, because in the traditions that we grew up in, I mean, here's an aside that I meditated on, and it may be real or not. John Crawford was 28 years old. I argued that no black man over the age of 50 would have felt he could walk through Walmart with a play gun. That our awareness as older black people of the tyranny of white supremacy is so great. And yet young black people, people of color, are living in this weird world of cognitive dissonance where they may read their bell hooks books, they may do all this other work, but they still believe they're, quote, free. They believe in the sort of postmodern notion of liberal individualism so that they can do things that seem like really insane to those of us who are older because they have had this whole sense of themselves as you have the same freedom as everybody else. You have the same rights as everybody else. I mean, we hear that with black people who are making themselves look as white as possible. I'm just exercising my freedom of choice, of desire and design. And I think that that is an interesting, it's just something I'm thinking about those generational differences around what does it mean that younger black people, who in some ways I feel are far more endangered. I'm 62, I turned 62 last month, but they don't seem to know that they're endangered. They don't seem to know that they're not safe in certain spheres of whiteness. Because something in the culture has told them that they are free and that they are safe and that they can occupy themselves in the world like everybody else. And I do think that as older black people, we don't think we can occupy ourselves in the world like everybody else. You know, I don't think I can get on an elevator with 5 drunk white people. I think drunk white people are some of the scariest people on the planet. I don't presume that I can be safe. Even though I may not presume them to be horrible people or dangerous, I have to care enough about myself to not cross into that sphere where I could be hurt. There was a hand up over there that I can't quite see you, but I saw your hand. Did you just lose your thought?
Oh, no, that was like an amen hand.
I actually thought we needed more amen hands. I was a little disappointed when Imani was talking. Okay, your name?
My name is Marcelo Maia. I'm with DECTAP New York, which I think is an original transgressive organization. But my question is, how to get out of this bubble? I mean, it's, to me, maybe difficult for a teacher to teach a captive audience who choose to be there how to be transgressive. But how we teach people who are just oblivious of what's going on, how important it is for them to get a clue and to transgress.
But that's where I think Pema Chodron, Buddhist teacher, has it. Start where people are. Like, I have this little weird business in my town, in my small town. I call it Spirit Talk. And for $20, people can come to me if they have a problem, a life problem, or something, and we can work on the issue together and try to create a solution. Because what I see is most people are very open to a different way of thinking, if they can see how that different way of thinking applied to the reality of their lives can produce a positive change. And so I feel like I use theory, but I invite the people that come to me to reflect, to have existential reflection on whatever issue. And issues can be very mundane. One of my friends fired from a job. I want to move to Portland. I'm going to go back to the little Christian fundamentalist town that I grew up in because my daughter says she's very lonely. And then we can talk about how she felt growing up in that town crushed her spirit. So why would you want to take your daughter back to that town? What are the options for you? You may say, well, I have no money. And another project I've been doing is with collaborative things where getting together with groups of mainly women who put a problem on the table. My husband's died, I'm 70, years old. I've always hated where we live. I feel like I would like to make a change, but everyone says you're too old to make a change. Part of what we do then in the collaborative, cooperative moment is we all take what is our knowledge that we can bring to this person that may assist them in making a change. And I think that it's that kind of education for critical consciousness that's engaged in the practice of people's lives. And you know, it's an interesting thing because people, we have become such a therapeutic-oriented culture, which is so tied to money again, that the idea that in a conversation with a friend, you might learn something about how you could live better in the world, I think is not a common sense model for most people anymore. It's in fact that I should shut down and I should, you know, go to therapy or go to something where I pay money. And not just think myself, common sense. I love television evangelists, and Joyce Myers calls that sanctified common sense, that people don't deploy their sanctified common sense. Because I think a lot of those things of starting with people where they are, for me, money is a big issue in the lives of people I know and love, in my family, in my students. In the laws of money, the lessons of life, Susie Orman says, you know, find out how people are dealing with their money, and you'll find out how they're dealing with other issues in their lives. You know, whether they're taking accountability, whether they're living within their means, whether they're causing themselves undue emotional stress with debt or whatever. And I think I just think that that kind of concrete practice that is inspired by progressive politics has more power to move people than just telling people something. I've been looking like mad, since my birthday evening when we were sitting around kind of drinking and we were looking at the Queen Latifah skit from Saturday Night Live 2009, Excedrin Headache. I don't know if any of you have seen it, like, Excedrin headache for racial tension. And I was thinking about how that 1 minute skit does more towards helping a lot of white people I know understand the stress people of color often feel in the workforce than a whole essay by a bell hooks or someone else. Because there is something about hearing the person, you know, when she starts off, and the moment I get to work, it's Denise this, it's Denise that. But my name isn't Denise. And just the whole idea of what begins to press upon you and how you begin to feel more dehumanized or less yourself. And it's there in 1 minute. And so I did want to say that about media. I try to always hold that media is in and of itself is not bad. TV in and of itself is not bad. TV can be an enormously moving forward. Help people to move forward in their thinking, in their lives. What do you think helped men to move forward? Maybe you guys are too young to remember, but I remember when we first started talking about gender equality, and we talked about, sorry, I forgot to turn off my cell phone. We first started talking about gender equality and the whole question of whether men could be secretaries. And I mean, many of you probably don't even remember that the big issue was that male fingers were just too big to type on those machines. And so we couldn't have equality around these things. And remember that part of the bringing over so many black female slaves, it was believed that their fingers were better for picking cotton than the fingers of men. But my point is, somewhere along the way, we had a nonviolent revolution that happened in this culture that began with computers. That as men were told, if you want to be a player in the world of today, you're going to have to know how to use a computer. And your big old fat fingers, your masculine patriarchal fingers, are going to have to learn how to type on those little keys. And do we not see? I mean, look at those keys on your iPhones. I mean, to me, sometimes it's amazing to contemplate revolutions like that, that happen not just because people were told that if they wanted to continue to be players in the business world or whatever, but because the PR around this was so positive. It was like, if you really want to be in touch with the world, I mean, think about that, because I think those are the kind of ways we're going to have to think in terms of revolutionary notions of how to live and be in the world, that we have to be able to think about what are ways that we create positive revolutions for people. And I have to say that advertising and marketing can be very useful in studying how people do what they do. I mean, I sometimes just giggle when I see men in suits and they have their little tiny keyboards and they're just working away, because I'm old enough to remember a day that that was like religiously opposed, that they're not going to be able to do that. Women will have to be the secretaries forever because they're the only ones who can type. Last couple of questions. Yes.
I have a question.
No, I'm sorry. The woman behind you and then you.
Oh, hi. My name is Masai. I'm a student here at the school. There's been a question on my mind for probably the last couple of years. I personally believe that one of the biggest oppressions placed on women is the issue of sexual objectification. And I think that in media, especially in the entertainment industry, which is an industry that directly relates to me because I am a rapper. And in that industry, you're not able to get anywhere unless you either sexually objectify yourself or you assimilate to this, I guess, patriarchal, masculine identity. And in our society in general, it's like women, especially black women, are sexually objectified. But the counter argument to it is always this theory of sexual liberation. Mm. And I've been wondering in my mind, where is there a line drawn where we can distinguish between sexual objectification and sexual liberation?
Well, that's why we have a panel called Whose Booty Is This? And one of the things that we're talking about in that panel is that when Spike Lee did She's Gotta Have It in 86. Remember, the big question was, whose pussy is this? But all of a sudden, here we are in 2014, and it's all about the booty. And I know many of you have seen the Anaconda video, that of course is all about the booty. And so that I think that that's the tension on that particular panel, to talk about how we confuse sexual hedonism with sexual liberation, and why it is we don't really know what does feminist sexual liberation look like. I mean, because think about the old days when we said, you know, feminism is the politic and lesbianism is the practice. That was really the sexual out. Like, if you want to be free as a woman in your body and in your sexuality, become a lesbian. Because as a hetero woman, you're never going to be free. You'll always be in bondage to the patriarchy. And so I think we haven't effectively discussed and answered those questions, and I don't know that we will do so on our panel, but that's really what the topic is. So if you have time to come to that, because that's something that I think about all the time. Those of you who were with me in the spring know that I brought up celibacy, and people kind of laughed and mocked me. And so celibacy as a choice in relation to our bodies, our sexualities, that there may be times in a young woman's life where she may want to choose periods of celibacy as she grows and reflects and what have you. And people just dismiss that because they didn't see that as cool. And we're back to Shannon's challenge to our notions of transgression and cool. I guess ain't nothing cool about celibacy. And I know of myself, having been celibate for the last 15 years, that I often don't feel like it's cool, and I often think, oh, what's wrong with me? What's my problem? Or people will say, oh, you're really sick. You need to get some, girl. You know, and I mean, and it's this whole, I mean, think about that whole construction of heteronormative patriarchal sex as healing? Mm-hmm. Not. Our last question here, your name?
My name is Marissa. I had a question actually for Carlin about the when you were talking about decentering whiteness and the process that your organization went through. I'd like to know more about when it shifted from the use of texts and source materials to a more explicit conversation in a workplace setting about being queer and really reflecting on whether we're being transgressive.
That's an amazing question, and one that's ongoing, and one we think about a lot in our staff and our students who work in the center, right, as an academic center, as a kind of a center that's sort of applied, intersectional, women's and gender studies. What does staff training look like? What does it look like? So there are lots of amazing kind of memes on privilege going around the internet right now. What does it mean to teach those? What does it mean to show the trailer to Dear White People, which is coming out soon? You all will get to see it. We won't get to see it in Green Bay. What does it mean to show that trailer and talk about this is a parody and a satire of a white majority university? What does it mean here? How do we think about this trailer here? It's ongoing. This year we're doing stuff on superheroes, and our question is, who's your hero? And this panel of heroic people, who's your hero? Because that's so fundamental. And so we have especially artists and drawers of color at the center. Adila Funama just talked about the blackness of superheroes and said, you know, when you think about Superman, why do we imagine that this white guy flying around in the universe is the arbiter of justice? That's never been true for black people. And I asked my students, is that how you've thought about Superman? So I don't know. This is an ongoing conversation. I mean, I've just been sitting here thinking, even in the presence of a white majority institution, for white people on my campus to look at a woman of color for a whole year. I mean, these posters, these shirts, right? They were all around our campus. What has that done? I mean, if we could have, you know, an anthropologist, if we could have someone do some on the ground research of what does it mean for you to look at bell hooks as an icon for a year on our campus? Decolonizing imagination, it's a work in progress. I mean, I will talk to you about this till the cows come home, so I think, Wisconsin reference, I think we're about to close our panel, but I love talking about this question. It's the question of our lives, so.
Well, I want to say again that we are very thankful to all of you who came and who stayed in this room from 12 to 2, and I am especially thankful to this illustrious panel of women from whom I have learned and from whom I continue to grow, and from whom I get to know what it is to love. Thank you.